heartening to see this going on. The treatment of these resistance priests, and the best piece of advice that I can give you is that, if you are still attending a Neo-SXPX chapel, to really not engage yourself with the individuals in the chapel, because you're only going to catch that brainwash that unfortunately they're catching from their own priests and from Bishop Fillet. I can tell you a few instances here in the independent chapel that I attend, where a priest, he's independent, but he certainly sides with Bishop Fillet and some of the words, that he used, and they're just brainwashed. They have not studied what Bishop Fillet has truly been saying now for quite some time. And again, please pick up this book, The Impossible Reconciliation, because this makes it very clear of the new direction. And then also, again, some more evidence. SXPX had an article from Michael Matt, which they posted on their website, and in and of itself, it's not bad. But again, this is just to demonstrate their sway and their lean, and kind of their mishmash, if you will, of convergence with these pseudo traditionalists. Because Michael Matt, his position is completely ludicrous, with this real versus virtual council, that somehow the council itself is not teaching heresy and it's not modernism. And so, when the SXPX starts using apologists like that, and they continue to use John Venneri, who sits on both sides of the fence, it presents and is misguiding to the faithful. Okay, because now the faithful is going to go out and they're going to start listening to these apologists when they really shouldn't. Okay, again, the truth hurts sometimes. But if anyone can point out, objectively speaking, what I have said that is wrong, you're free to do so. And you can, leave your number and I will call you, just as I try to call anyone who's interested in talking. And another point I would like to make, because we're going forward with this, because at this point I have very little tolerance with some of the feedback that's coming from these Neo-SXP priests. And so if you have priests who are, when you're trying to present, obviously this new position, if you are still in a Neo-SXPX chapel, and you're getting threats of, being denied communion, or you're being threats of being thrown out, please call me, please email me, or and then I'll give you my number, because I would like that priest's name and number, and then I will go ahead and give him a call so that we can have a one-on-one talk. And then, if as long as we're staying on the objective level, if we have to, we'll do a blog to continue to show, how the SXPX not only has swayed in their position theologically, but how they continue to demonstrate themselves to not be following what it is they are in, what their minds think they are following. So again, we have to continue to pray for unity, but again, we cannot compromise. We cannot be a part of this quote-unquote pseudo-traditionalist ecumenism. And I think it was, I'm not sure who coined that. I know I just recently heard a sermon from Father Hugo, and that pretty much nails it right on the head. It's just the hodgepodge of these individuals getting together, and they have, for all intents and purposes, there really is no unity, because you've got a group of individuals thinking Vatican II is Orthodox. Then you got, John Venneri, who sits on both sides of the fence. Then you got Michael Matt, who thinks it's just the spirit of Vatican II, and that there's another council coming that's going to reinterpret Freemasonry in a better sense, into a Catholic sense. And so I have no idea where they think that that is going to go, other than it's not going anywhere, as much as they want to convince themselves. So again, putting that aside, we just wanted to demonstrate to individuals how the Neo-SXPX continues to lean in the wrong direction towards modernist Rome. We know that Bishop Fillet is meeting with a representative in the Vatican here. I believe it's in the next 2 weeks. I think it's the 21st. Now, in and of itself, it's not necessarily bad, but we already know what transpired in 2012, where everything was meant to be hush hush, if you will, and we weren't supposed to know. As if, as a Catholic layman, I shouldn't know what my, the superiors are teaching and what they actually believe, so that I can make a decision for my soul whether I should be there, and there whether I should be teaching other people should be there. So that's completely ludicrous what they tried to do and tried to hide everything. And then also silencing their priests, which is grievous sin, by the way. It's a mortal sin to tell the priests, your subordinates to keep quiet on Vatican II and the Pope while trying to selfishly pursue your canonical agreement. That's grievous sin. And so, there's been a lot of mistakes. So, from our perspective, the Neo-SXPX continues to crumble. The theological ineptitude comes out in their various articles on their own website, on Dici, and then also, of course, just in the various talks that we can prove, meaning it's not hearsay or internet gossip that these particular individuals are saying, whether they're clergy or laity. This is provable. And we know that certainly their position has changed. Again, in April of this year, Bishop Fillet had made a comment that there is no heresy in Vatican II, which is erroneous. It shows again that their position now is that Vatican II is legitimate, that we're just resisting some error. And again, that's not even what their founder stood for. And so, again, let's not think that we're trying to subjectively attack anyone, but on that objective level, we have to qualify individuals, okay, based upon what they're teaching and saying, because the faith, again, is at stake. It's very, very important that we present truth, okay, and the truth is going to offend. It's going to offend a number of people. And unfortunately, if we're going to take a sample, if you will, of let's say there's 10 supposed traditionalists, quote unquote traditionalists, I would say 8 or 9 of them fall into this hodgepodge mix now. Okay, they truly think that they are traditionalists, but again, according to how the popes have spoken, and in particular with Pope St. Pius X, we know that they're not true traditionalists. We cannot accept Vatican II. Certainly, the heresy of ecumenism ties in with the Cilianist movement, of which Pope St. Pius X said, these madmen, these dreamers, they have the audacity to call themselves Catholics. So within that circle of the pseudo trad group, you would have individuals who actually hold to that, or then you would just have some individuals saying, well, that's just an error or mistake. It's not heresy, when it is a heresy. Based on that heresy alone, we could not commune with any of those individuals who are holding to it. And so we fail to make key theological distinctions. Again, it kind of just lays everything flat to where you can just kind of wander wherever you want in the conciliar church, and you truly cannot. I mean, the conciliar church is a modernist, Gnostic, liberal sect. It truly is by its definition. And so we're not saved Vacantists, as the Neo-SXPX would have you try to believe. We again take the common opinion of the esteemed theologians concerning popes who teach heresy, or anyone for that matter who teaches heresy, whether it's a prelate or a pope, that certainly we are just waiting for the church to correct herself. And ultimately, we of course are teaching that what we are saying is going to manifest itself as a reality. So even as Saint Athanasius said at his time, while his crisis was going on, he clearly denoted to everyone that there were these Arian heretics, these Arian aliens, if you will, he called them. He simply stated, they have the buildings, we have the faith, right? So he was forming a theological opinion, and he was teaching others that you could not be a part of that. Okay, so you will find amongst these pseudo traditionalists, such as John Vianney and some of these others, saying that we can't say that. We don't have the authority to say that. We don't have to have the authority to say that, my good friends. Okay, we can form theological opinions, and we can help others, so long as we have a good formation and we're standing on solid ground, if you will, and we can prove our point. Even the Sede Vacantist has his right to his opinion. We, of course, don't agree on that, but I would not deny that they have that right to that opinion, and that they can speak that publicly. So, I really do feel sorry for the faithful. They really do have to chew through all this information. But the one good thing that has come out is this: now individuals truly like myself had to go back through and study all the councils and study, all the encyclicals, to study what the church taught before Vatican II and what, now the conciliar church teaches. Now people have to go back into the society, and that's why I really want you to get this book, The Impossible Reconciliation. Go to the website truetrad.com. You can, of course, go to, let's see, there's Save Our SXPX, there's the Recusant, there's my website, Tradcat Knight, and there are various others that I have all the links on my page there. And so you have to sift through that information, and you have to pick out, objectively speaking, what these priests are saying and catch them in their contradictions. For example, there was a priest, I forget his last name now, I think it was Father Lasney, in his response to Father Chazil, which he got caught in a contradiction, saying that Archbishop Lefebvre never called the conciliar church or identified it as a separate church. And I listed about 20 to 25 quotes where he did say that. Okay, so what I'm saying is the Neo SXPX knows.